out there.
Welcome to another episode of Frocks in the Box.
Yes, and we've had some very interesting letters this week. Well, perhaps you're not going to see anything from up there. It's a very, very big location indeed. Maybe you'd like to come a little bit closer? Yes, fine, right.
Well, this letter says, where, oh where, can my 6 feet, 7 inches tall son, he sounds gorgeous, with an inside leg measurement of 36 inches. Where can they buy fashionable trousers off the peg?
Nowhere is the answer.
Yeah, it's a real problem, you know, and I wish designers would take note of this, because if they just leave those cuffs or hems undone, we could actually put them up ourselves.
Exactly. Not everybody is the same size, you know. Now, I've got a letter here from a Richard Brooks in Oxford who says he enjoys the show, and he'd just like us to know how fashionable Oxford is. He's sending a photograph of some artwork of Mr. Bill Hines at his house, number 2, untitled 86 New High Street, and here is the photograph. It's a shark. It's a shark stuck into a roof. I'm sorry, this is a fashion programme. It doesn't even have any trousers on. Get a grip out there, would you?
Well, later on in the show, we're going to be telling you exactly why a Chanel suit is so special, and also we're going to meet Karl Lagerfeld.
Yes, and I shall be visiting the House of Sin. But first, the summer is over. It's time to get our autumn wardrobe together. Which is the most fashionable city to go shopping in?
Paris.
No, think again.
New York.
No, what about Glasgow?
Muriel, Glasgow is full of people wearing kilts.
It's not. It is full of designer shops and incredibly trendy people. And by the magic of television and the magic of our tartan bag, I will whisk you there and show you.
This is so ridiculous and tacky.
It isn't. Hold the magic bag. Believe in me.
Muriel,
it might be tacky, it might be ridiculous, but it's worked.
It has not worked. This is Hawaii.
No. This is Glasgow. You might not believe it. We are in the Winter Gardens in Glasgow, the People's Palace. And I can tell you something. Glasgow's a pretty trendy place to buy clothes.
Prove it.
Then, Mazelle.
I'm most impressed. I think it's a fabulous shop.
Well, it's the warehouse. It's been open for about 7 years, and that's why all the Glasgow punters are trendy as get out, because you can come in here and buy great off the peg design away like this. Jean-Paul Gaultier, you'll know it.
Mm, pretty good. Really nice. I think you should get it.
You think so? Well, have you seen the price tag? Do you think it'll look like the bad fairy, though?
Maybe.
I do. Mm. 3 wishes. See you. You're not getting them. In Glasgow, you look a stotter hen.
I know, I feel like what? I feel like I just stepped out of the pages of Vogue here.
You did. But in fact, you are in the British corner of Cruise for Women, and are you quite impressed with this shop?
I am impressed. And you know, I'm so impressed that I've actually found a pair of trousers that I can pull off the rail, and they fit. They're the right length.
Yes, every age catered from, 18 to 80, and the designers. What one is that?
This is by Ghost.
And also long enough to fit Helvin's legs. She's a freak. Yet another fabulous designer shop in Glasgow, Itchini San. Did you see anything you like?
I sure have.
Give us a look, hen. You move like a panther, Marie. And what is it did you have on?
This is a Jo Casely Hayford, and it's a coat dress. It's really cleverly designed and fabulous to wear.
And this is a quilted satin thing from a designer called Avu. And this is a shop that has loads of designers under one roof, so you can come in and you don't have to traipse from shop to shop. In fact, it has a Belgian designer who's only featured in Scotland, no one else in Britain.
Absolutely, Dries Van Noorden.
The very one. You are so impressed with Glasgow, you can barely speak.
You're right.
Just wait till you see the lunch.
Even better.
But really trendy bars and restaurants too. This is the Bar Luxembourg in Glasgow. Are you still impressed?
I am, but I'd be more impressed if I could find some salt.
Waiter, salt please. Very bad service.
Waiter? I'm not a waiter. I'm the owner.
Oh, I'm so sorry. You must be Colin Barr then.
Yes.
Oh, hello, Colin. Terribly sorry.
That's all right.
Isn't that that jacket that you tried on earlier?
The Jean-Paul Gaultier. Indeed it is.
Yes.
So you must be a trendy beast.
Yes, which I had to be, yes. Guess we can, believe it or not, we can get Jean-Paul Gaultier here in Glasgow. We don't have to travel all the way to London now.
That's a relatively new thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it's fantastic, yeah.
Well, why do you think Glasgow's so packed with designer clothes then?
Well, I think it's the buyers for the boutiques. They really need a job now, and they know what the people want. And if they can sell this up here, then why not, you know? And the kids, they want the fashions. So
it's obviously really important to Glasgow people to dress up.
It is, yes. They're all fashion victims up here.
You've noticed that, haven't you? You thought everyone's red trendy in Glasgow.
Yeah. They all look great so far.
Along with Colin and Bar Luxembourg, a lot of Glasgow style comes from thriving new designer labels. Ready-to-wear outfits like this one from Lex McFadgen and this couture ball gown by Spencer Railton find a willing market with Glasgow's fashionable clientele. On the eccentric side is this creation by Francis Ferry and Crawford McKenzie in plastic and brocade. And this extraordinarily bizarre confection is by Peter McGrath. Peter also specialises in hats.
I only like to sell anything to someone who I think looks good in things. And some people can wear hats. People with style, people like Angela and Stephen, they can carry hats fairly well. So I like to make things that tie in with the clothes.
So you mean if someone walked into the shop and they put something on and you felt they looked really dreadful, you would insist that they wouldn't buy it?
Yeah.
Really?
I don't see why not. Because Glasgow is such a small, close-knit city that if someone goes out looking terrible in something I've made, people will hear.
It would be obviously for some sort of special event, like a charity ball or I think it's a bit much for a wedding, but it would have to be something very special.
Obviously, you're happy living and working in Glasgow, but is it important for you to be known in London? I mean, do you want to go to London at all?
Well, I have sold my ready-to-wear collection in London before, but at the moment I'm too busy in Glasgow with my private clients.
So you're happy here?
So I'm really quite happy here, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the Glaswegian woman is very stylish anyway.
Yeah.
Isn't she?
They're very appreciative of something just a little bit different.
Now, what kind of a designer would you describe yourself as?
Wonderful. Apart from wonderful, I tend to design a sort of an upmarket, expensive looking, but not expensive to buy street look.
And do you get a lot of customers?
Yeah, I'm finding that people are interested in designer clothes that they feel they can wear. And hopefully I can sort of service that type of market that are looking for the Gaultier look without paying the Gaultier prices.
Well, have you changed your mind about Glasgow then, Marie?
Mm-hmm.
Not so much tenements and razor gangs, more designer shops and trendy beasts.
Oh, it's been fabulous. I love it.
Look what someone's left in the toilet. Oh, what a surprise.
The dreaded bag.
It's not the dreaded bag, it is the magic Scottish bag. Since we've been to Glasgow, I think we should go to your hometown.
Hawaii,
right.
Oh, sorry.
I can't believe it. Some kind of aloha this is. Muriel, I've had it with you.
Well, what do you expect for $4.99?
On with the show. For both men and women, the military look is very popular this autumn, and it's available in every price range. So look for those rows of metal buttons, look for those earthy camouflage colors, and those heavy padded bomber jackets, and also those shoes that mean serious business.
Time.
military look. Oh, do you go for men in uniform?
No.
Oh, they go for me if they're traffic wardens. Now it's time for what's new in fashion.
Hello, ladies. Roll up all this lovely stuff I've got in here. First of all, on what's new, is this lovely clock from Bennington. All in red, right, or you can get them in blue or grey or whatever, all Italian. And the other thing about this clock that's so good is it tells the time and all, doesn't it? Isn't that marvellous? Also, right, this is a must for all you executives. It's called the Walk Fan, right? It's from Taiwan. You turn it on and you get your own little personal fan of air, right, that no one else can have, so you can tell them to get out of it if they use it. That's lovely. Now this, you are going to love, all you ladies, right? You may wonder what these geezers are. I'll tell you, they are to give you a little bit of extra support. They're made by the Emmanuels, what made that princess lady die, God bless her, made her wedding dress, right? Well, now they're making these, so I suppose whereas before, right, they was making stuff for the House of Windsor, now they're making them for all you ladies to look like Barbara Windsor. Ain't that lovely? Now, what I want to show you last of all, right, is these lovely stuff here. This is your channel number 5, right? Eau de Parfum. It's all new, right? Eau de Parfum. Comes in a traditional bottle, right? Or in this lovely black box, all gilded up around the edge, right? Which is a spray on site, right? And it's called Channel, right? But it ain't a Channel Tunnel, although it costs about as much as that. And I'll tell you, don't have pen and ink and all.
Well, to save me the trouble of street trading, Chanel officially launched their Eau de Parfum at Sotheby's. The mystique of number 5 has always been associated with intriguing women. Jean Shrimpton, Ali McGraw, Catherine Deneuve have all smiled seductively for Chanel. Their newest face, Carol Bouquet, was in London last week for the party.
Well, it's a work, but it's a nice work.
You have good fun. And of course, you don't do it for the money, do you?
Well, no one says that.
And do you actually wear the stuff when you're at home? When you take.
When I'm at home, I wear a pair of jeans and a white t-shirt. Yeah.
And no and Chanel sneakers. Number 5.
I don't wear perfume when I'm at home by myself. You know, usually I wear perfume trying to seduce somebody, or so alone by myself.
Would I seduce anyone with that? Can you smell that? Do you know what that is?
No. But with your skin, that's Chanel number 5.
It is. Yes.
But with the man's skin, you know, it changes everything. It's a very good smell. To tell you that.
Thank you very much.
She sniffed my hand. She sniffed my hand. Never gonna wash that again.
Never thought you washed anyway, Harry. Well, we'll be back in a few minutes to meet Karl Lagerfeld, Chanel's influential designer.
And we'll be looking into Madame Cynthia Payne's wardrobe.
Join us then.
Coco Chanel's influence on female style is the fashion legend of this century. She rose to fame in the 1920s, becoming a success de scandale by designing for the female form. Out went the corsets, the tight waists, and whalebone. She popularized the fabrics of the working class, like tweed, and even made dresses out of jersey, the material of her lover's underwear. As the creator of Paris Chic, she never lost sight of elegance and femininity in her creations. The recent Chanel exhibition in London celebrated the emergence of Coco's successor as director of design, Karl Lagerfeld, His outrageous collection, created around his muse, Inés de la Frassange, has re-established the avant-garde quality of Chanel.
You know, Chanel is for me like playing a part like for an actor, you see, because Chanel is not me. So it's me doing something, I wouldn't say outside of me, but in a different way. Chanel was a kind of fashion designed by a woman for a woman. So for me, it's like doing Inés Valero, and that's all. So it's very different, because when I do KL, my own stuff, it's just me. When I do Fendi, it's me, my Italian way. And Chanel, for me, it's like playing in a part. Mm-hmm. Like being an actor.
Yes.
A graphic actor.
Carl, when did the first Chanel suit appear? Do you know?
You mean in history?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Chanel suits are, in fact, all different. The one from the 20s, look next room, they are very different from the one of the 50s. In fact, what everybody thinks is a typical Chanel suit is from the 50s. Mm-hmm. The one with the four pockets and the braid, it existed in the 20s, but it was completely different. What we think is a timeless Chanel suit is, in fact, something from the 50s.
Yeah. How many do you show in each collection?
It depends. It's a question of the mood and the moment. And if I have nice materials and if I'm in a mood for it, it depends. Oh, let's say 10. But they're all different, and in a way, they are the same. But we try to find new techniques, new way to do it, different braids and things like this. This season, we used a new technique, what is so difficult to do that it costs double to make a Chanel suit this season than it costed last season.
Carl, you have really brought a breath of fresh new life into Chanel. How long do you think you can continue to do this?
As long as we are copied, so much as we are copied for the moment, it's interesting to watch that, and we have to change. And the healthiest thing in fashion is change. So you can stay Chanel, but change. So as long as we are copied, it's fun to do something else and play in different way with the same mood, the style, and the atmosphere. But it has to change always, because if we would do today the old look of the 50s and early 60s, I think nobody would copy it and would like it. Because in fact, what we did is we made a kind of Chanel that people think it's Chanel. I don't know if it's Chanel, but who cares? People think it is, and that's what cares.
Well, if you can't afford the £700 to £800 it costs to buy the original, there are a lot of copies around.
There are indeed. There's this one from Winsmoor, the suit copying all the wee Chanel details, like the gold button there. Cheaper than that, even, is Next, with the traditional Chanel braiding. Oh, and this is the hat that goes with the Winsmoor suit. And this is the cheapest of all. This is Geoffrey Rogers, and I've put on flash trash jewellery to make myself look like Coco Chanel herself. Mind you, it's funny that I have to wear the copy and Marie gets to wear the real thing, isn't it?
No.
Well, it's a well-worn path to this week's celebrity wardrobe. Many a person has trod on this quiet suburban street, some with luncheon vouchers, I have mine, and some without. Because it's a celebrity we're going to see of some magnitude, a woman with a lot of frocks and a lot of very strange hobbies. Who could it possibly be? Why, it is Cynthia Payne.
Welcome to the House of Sin.
Well, here we are. This is the Madam's bedroom, can
yes,
you call
this
that?
Yes, Madam's
the
bedroom.
The Madam's bedroom. Now, is this the wardrobe then, Cynthia? This is where it all happens.
Ah, yes. This is all my clothes.
Well, would you say that you're a very fashion-conscious person then? I mean, how do you pick your clothes?
Well, not really, but of course, since becoming infamous, not famous, I've had to be more clothes conscious. And somebody of the name of Mark Scott is going to design my clothes in future.
So, like, for instance, the dress you've got on, I mean, what made you pick that?
Well, the dress I've got on is really a dress, really, I've got horrible memories. This is the dress when I got raided in 1986. There has been two raids. One I went to prison for, this one I didn't. And this was the dress I wore where I tacked the money down my cleavage when the police paid me on entrance, and I tacked it down my cleavage. So it made my boobs bigger than what they were, I think.
What's this one? That's rather nice.
Yes, this is rather sweet. I wore this just after I won my trial. Jonathan Ross wanted me on one of his first programmes on The Last Resort, and I wore that with Boy George. Very fond of Boy George. He calls me Auntie Sin. And he's really quite a sweet boy.
But you obviously remember them all by the events rather than where you
got
them.
Oh, yes, yeah.
So,
some have good memories, some have bad.
For instance, this is a very exciting one.
I love that one.
Because I seem to remember seeing this somewhere.
Yes, it's all in the newspapers and it's in the books. I bought this, believe it or not, in Oxfam for £2. And when I went to court in the witness box, I wore it. And in the film, I saw Julie Waters wearing a little black outfit. So when I went to give my evidence, I pretended I was Julie Waters. And I dressed exactly like her in the film. And £2. And it's it was a Miss Worth dress, but I really looked nice in it.
This is a very strange accessory to have in your wardrobe, Cynthia. Is it, looks to me like it's a belt for a dressing gown, is it?
A belt? Well, I suppose you could use
it. Yes, that's obviously what it is. Like a lot of people have them,
yes,
don't they?
Yes, these days. A yeah. lot of girls wear black leather these days.
Well, that's very nice.
Now, I've got many happy memories of this. Last month, I had to go to Paris to promote the film, and I had to stand in all the traffic. And because you know what French traffic was like, having my photograph taken outside the Moulin Rouge like this, there's all this traffic, you know, all going round me. And funny enough, this was bought by French dressing in Streatham, so it was appropriate.
Ooh, what a vision of loveliness.
Well, this dress I call my finest hour dress.
Why?
Well, I just won the trial and personal services was on in the West End. And this is what I call my premier dress. And I arrived in the foyer and I had a policeman flanked either side of me. And it was just wonderful. So this dress has very happy memories.
Where did you buy that from?
Well, I bought this from Holders of Croydon, actually. They do styles for the older woman, and I think this is lovely.
Because it's this season's colours as well. You're absolutely fashionable in brown.
Yes, yes, they make sure that I don't go outside the shop. Unless it's...
Right, oh, Mrs. Cynthia Payne.
Oh, I am Miss Cynthia Payne.
This is, you are under arrest for keeping a disorderly house.
Well, you've made it a disorderly house, not
Anything
me.
Anything you say will be taken down and used in evidence against you. And I think you're going to say rather a lot by the sound
of
you.
I'm going to say not
guilty.
Not guilty. Not guilty. She's not a girl. She's not one of my girls. She's not one of my girls. I'm going to plead not guilty, I'm telling you.
Well, you obviously didn't realise that it was Harry dressed up as a policeman.
No, I didn't. When, I did think there was something up because you know what the slot are like, you know, a single noise and it's cut immediately and they let the doorbell ring and nothing happened. This is turning into game for a laugh, I tell you.
Well I'll vouch for you in court.
How sweet of you, thank you. That's all the frocks from us this week. If you would like a fact sheet, then you can write to us at Frocks in the Box, Show 4, PO Box 123, Southampton SO9 7HH. Or if you prefer, telephone Southampton, the code's 0703 227744.
Well, next week we're going to show you how our fashion sense is tied up to our star sign.
And I shall be looking in the wardrobe of Playboy couple Victor Lowndes and Marilyn Cole. And I should say, hers contains a little bit more than she used to wear when she was a centrefold spread. So, see you then.
Bye.